Hello, hello, everyone. I'm writing the topic of today and waiting for Frank. Hello, hi, everyone. Hi, Murat. Hi, everyone. Today we will be talking about some food and wine pairings. Hi, Pavlos, Maria, Carlos, Robin. Okay, Frank is here, so I'm gonna invite.
We'll start the last session of week 7. Frank is on his way. Yes, Frank is here. Hi, Frank.
Good evening. Hello.
Good evening. How are you?
Good, good, good. A lovely week, great weather. Yes.
And last session of the week. And you already have enough of me this week, so you'll have a break.
Yeah.
Okay, so today we'll talk about wine and food pairing.
Yes.
Nonsense.
I've got some great advice.
Yeah, I have great advice as well. My wine, and this is a lovely Corpinat, and I think I'm just going to pair it with this orange or maybe with this kiwi. Who knows? Yeah, so...
Do whatever you like, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
That's my advice. Yes, do whatever mm-hmm. you like. Yeah.
But I definitely will ask you a few advice about your favorite pairings, and also a few people before the session, they told me that I should ask you some particular things. Your favorite pairing of knödel mm-hmm. and poyak and lamb pairing, and also someone else that I cannot pronounce. Let me describe you. A fish soup originally from Marseille.
Ah, bouillabaisse.
Yes, that one. So this was like the special request for today's session.
Good, good, good. good. Mm. Well, first of all, my advice for knödel, I would always pair that with Claude Lacoulet Serran. Because then you eat and drink two things that are both disgusting.
I knew that today's session would be funny.
Yeah. With bouillabaisse, but that's a better question. Bouillabaisse. I would say, I love bouillabaisse actually, but it's a very mm-hmm. powerful dish
uh-huh.
and very... Very thick in a way, and you know, and I would drink a powerful white wine like a white Châteauneuf du Pape or a white Priorat. I think this is the best combination. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm always almost like seeing the spirit in your eyes of like food and pairing recommendations.
No, but you know, I think the whole food and wine pairing thing is. Of course, some of your best wine moments mm-hmm. in your memory are linked to dinners, to eating and enjoying a great wine. On the other hand, you never eat alone. So basically, I think there's also the social context that plays a big role. If I think back of the bottles that made a huge impression that I, or maybe I should say enjoyed most, were mm-hmm. always bottles that I enjoyed in the company of pleasant people. You know, you're in a certain flow, you've got a great time together, and quite often with food, why not? And then you sometimes stumble on a bottle that really leaves a huge impression because it's so enjoyable, so great. So mm-hmm. I'm not going to deny that, first of all, that a lot of wine is consumed with food. Of course it is, and it should be, and it's great. But what I do not like about the subject is that I find it widely exaggerated, the whole idea of food and wine pairing. And there are many things I could say about that, but in any case, if people ask me to do food and wine pairing sessions, I refuse it. It's one of the topics that I will refuse to do, because basically everything I'm saying about the subject gives me the feeling I'm talking nonsense, because it's a subject that is so highly subjective that any attempt to make it objective ends with platitudes, with nonsense, with whatever. I don't like talking about the subject, you know. I'm not denying that there is a certain importance, but to try to find a kind of objective and let's say scientific basis is almost impossible. And actually, if you compare the books that have been written about the subject, you will see that either they completely contradict each other, or they are the same in the generalizations and what I call platitude that they are giving you. So terrible subject. No, I hate to talk about it.
And also, as you said, like food and wine pairing, it is very personal. You can recommend me food and pairing suggestions, but maybe I don't enjoy it the way you enjoy it, or maybe there's a different reaction is happening in my palate that it's not as same as you have. So, and also as you said, yes, we enjoy food, wine with people, but also it's like depending on our mood and also memories, no? If you're in a bad mood, maybe you can have the most expensive wine, but or better, best wine. I mean, I don't know if you even it exists, yeah. But you don't enjoy it.
No, it's true. But that's where the subjectivity comes in.
But I also, the other side of the story is, I think this whole food and wine pairing, and then also like giving so much importance to this food and wine pairing, makes people, the end consumer, simply sometimes feel stupid or intimidated.
Exactly, and that's my next point. I think actually the wine industry is shooting itself in the foot by putting so much emphasis on food and wine pairing, because it makes average consumers very insecure. And if I hear, I have a lot of experience with retail, with supermarkets, etc. Not just in Russia right now, but before, for example, for a number of years, I've been educating floor staff from a Dutch supermarket chain about wine, and for them the main issue was always food and wine pairing, because you get the crazy situation that people are buying a bottle of €5 and are nervous about the food and wine pairing, thinking, oh my God, you know, that's ridiculous. It's not that food and wine pairing is only about expensive wine. That's not what I mean. But I think if you are an average consumer, you shouldn't be worried about that, because it's bringing you into a complication that you will never be able to solve. Neither will, of course, the staff on the shop floor, and everything that you write on a back label or on a shelf talker is very general and completely forgets about personal wisdom whatsoever. You know, so it's very complicated. You know, and I remember like 15 years ago, I was invited to a dinner with a group of Dutch leading sommeliers here in the Netherlands, in Amsterdam. And we had all kinds of discussions because we had a dinner with different wines. And, you know, there was all kind of discussions whether the wine suited the food, whatever, blah, blah, blah. And then actually one guy, a friend of mine, said something, and I completely agreed with him. I said, guys, he said, why are we making it so complicated? The reality of our business as sommeliers is actually that 95% of our guests, if not more, order a dish that they like, order a bottle that they like, and they're completely happy with the combination. And that is actually the truth about it, you know, that is how it works. And so, my God, you know, don't make such a hassle.
Yeah, I mean, the food and wine, it is, I think it's one of the simplest humanistic things ever. And by making it this way, I think it's we're trying to make something which is simple, but more sophisticated and specialized. So people feel like they need to have specific knowledge and skill to enjoy it.
True.
You know, yeah, but in the end, it's just, no, you can just drink whatever you want and eat whatever you want.
I think so. I think so. Yeah, I think so. You know, one if you listen to, for example, there is for example, the remark that, you know, local food always goes well with local wine. That is fucking ridiculous, you know. Do you really want to drink a pasta with ragu in Tuscany with a Brunello di Montalcino? I think that's an awful combination. Mm-hmm. So that, and indeed, the one that you mentioned,
the fish.
Poyac, Poyac with a with a Poyac. It's absolutely ridiculous. First of all, it's ridiculous because actually there is no lamb in Poyac. It's just a name. But believe me, I've been 1,000 times in Poyac. I've never seen one sheep or lamb in the bloody place. You know why? Because there are vineyards everywhere, and there are you know. So and also it's very questionable whether actually a very tannic Cabernet Sauvignon-based wine like Poyac really suits lamb meat. It's ridiculous, actually. You know, I think of course in food and wine pairing you should try to avoid the major accidents. I fully agree because there are some things that really do not go together because either the wine will disappear or the food will suffer or whatever. By all means, try to disappear. Try to avoid that. You know? But finding the perfect combination it usually doesn't exist.
But I think like what you said, the understanding of what grows together and what goes well or pairs well together, I think it can be historically, if you think about like really long time ago, there were not really so much export or imports, but people didn't have so much access to other things. They had access to local food and local wine. So that's why they were pairing it. But it doesn't mean that it's an amazing combination.
No, exactly. You know, a very good example in case is sweet wine. By the end of the second half of the 19th century, the foundations for gastronomy as we experience it nowadays, influenced by France, were laid in the second half of the 19th century. And then the second half of the 19th century, the great white wine was sweet. Basically, it was sweet. People paid the highest prices for the great sweet wines. And you would be surprised if you see what they were drinking with sweet wines. For example, the gastronomic people and experts of the 19th century considered oysters and sauterne a perfect combination. And now we are saying that's ridiculous. It makes no sense. And oysters, you know, the wine should be dry. But who says that? What's the scientific the ground to say that sweet wine doesn't match oyster? It's completely subjective. Completely.
Actually, about one thing about this, one guest says, I think people should focus on not food and wine pairing, but focus on developing a personal wine profile to know his or her own favorite taste of wine and the styles. So actually, if you really enjoy this combination, it's up to you. I mean, for example, myself, I mean, as you said, sweet wines, there's this general rule of thumb, sweet wines pair with desserts. But I personally, sweet wines and desserts, I don't like it. I don't enjoy it much because I find it very cloggingly sweet and it's so overwhelming for me.
Yeah, it almost never works. And actually, if you go to Sauternes, if you go to Chateau d'Yquem, have we been there together?
No.
But no. They will tell you, please don't drink our wine with dessert. It makes absolutely no sense. And it's true because almost always the dessert is too sweet for any kind of sweet wine. And if it more or less matches, you get way too much sweetness in one go. So no, that's definitely true, but that's another issue actually. Why should we absolutely drink wine with every single course? You know, like dessert, forget about wine. chocolate. I mean, chocolate. Oh my God, that's a nightmare with wine. And you know, and every and I know, and people say, oh, but Banyuls and whatever. And no, Banyuls is more or less the least bad of all the choices with chocolate, but it's still not a really good combination. Poor Banyuls suffers from it, you know. So don't try to match wine with everything. Just skip wine if possible. And
here I will open a bracket here, because in New York I worked in a wine and chocolate bar for a long time, and I did a lot of wine and chocolate tastings. But I think there it was about like what we were trying to do, the match there. It's not the fruit profile most, but like matching the elements, the acidity, the alcohol, and the sweetness. So kind of like trying to have the balance. But in the end, it's obviously some people like it, some people don't like it. So it is your own personal taste.
That's true. Yeah.
But also on the other thing about that topic, I think it's also damaging some certain wines and profiles of the wines. Like, for example, sweet wines. Sweet wines pair with the dessert. So then we are limiting some certain wines for some things.
Yeah.
Instead of like giving the diversity and giving more option to this one, to wine to be enjoyed by the consumer, it's kind of like, why limiting it? So maybe wine industry, instead of doing something in positive, I think it may be doing something more negative.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree with you. Yeah.
Yeah.
By complicating it too much. This is what I liked in the new world, actually, because in the new world, they wouldn't be shy to put on the back label, this wine goes well with a burger or with a pizza.
Yeah.
You know? And actually, I like that, because that is bringing it down to a very basic level. And why not? You know, why should it always be so sophisticated?
Mm-hmm.
And I think in the new world, you know, where people are not so much busy with tradition and culture or whatever, as we are sometimes in Europe, they are not shy of doing that, you know, and why not? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But that's why many people drink beer. Like people, they try wine tastings maybe, and then they get tired of it and then just go and drinking beer or cocktails.
That's true. And there are sommeliers that will sometimes, you know, instead of a glass of wine with one course, they will present you a certain beer, which actually is quite fashionable now. 10 years ago, the fashion was to put in a sake. Mm-hmm. And you would get a sake at some point. And there was a time that in every wine menu, you would get a glass of sake. But, you know, why not? But on the other hand, I have to admit, I'm not at all a sake fan. I mean, I'm not against it, but it's just not my taste. I've never tried a sake that really pleased me. So you're not doing me a favor by putting in a sake. And actually, at that time, I often said to somebody else, we'll take the menu, but please no sake for us. You know, and I have a lovely sake. So I believe you, but I don't want it.
Exactly.
And nowadays, it's craft beers, of course, that pop up sometimes, and there are even examples. But then you go more into the alcohol-free segment, where people present you special juices and special teas. Well, why not? Be my guest. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There's a comment from Ricard. He says, Salus in Porrera has designed a menu with first dish, second dish, and dessert, all with sweet wines.
Yeah, it's possible.
Yeah.
It's possible because a few years ago, I was invited to speak at Gerard Kracher's Sweet Wine Symposium in his winery. And he had invited a number of well-known Austrian chefs who were presenting different courses. And indeed, we were matching all those courses with sweet wines. But, you know, there is so far also a point in this that I think a lot of people are not really aware of it. But if you try food also in very good restaurants, you really pay attention, you'll be surprised how often there's a touch of sweetness used in sauces, in whatever preparations. We're eating also at a high level. We're often eating much sweeter than we realize, and also at a low level, of course, because it basically, if you eat a McDonald's or a Burger King burger, the predominant taste, apart from a certain heartiness, umami, is sweetness, actually, because the ketchup and everything is very sweet. Yeah. And this is what people like. Yeah.
Actually, I remember in the day, almost like day one or two of the diploma with Konstantinos Lazarakis, he was mentioning about the tasting, and then he says, okay, no one will tell you that they don't like ketchup because it's the combination of acidity and the sweetness. So, It is.
So we eat much sweeter than we believe we do, actually. And and that makes it perfectly possible to combine with wines with a certain level of sweetness. They don't need to be fully sweet, but sweet. Some sweetness. But you know, the issue of sweetness in wine, that could easily be an issue for another talk later this month, because there's much to say about that. Somebody made a remark which you read out. About people should identify their own flavor, their taste profile, etc. That person was maybe, I'm not sure, referring to Tim Hennai, because Tim Hennai is a Californian master of wine, a good friend of mine, actually, and one of the MWs that I really appreciate most, who wrote a book called What's Your Vinotype? And an interesting story about Tim is actually that Tim, when I got to know Tim the first time, which was in the late 80s, he was working for Behringer, which was then an independent, very important winery in Napa Valley. And Tim was considered the food and wine pairing guru in the world. He was the worldwide expert in the subject. And the crazy thing is that nowadays he threw away all the things that he used to say, and he says, looking back at it, he says it was all rubbish. It was completely subjective, presented as if it was objective, and he doesn't believe in it at all anymore. And he indeed now says, first find out what your flavor profile is, your vinotype, what is the kind of food and wine that matches your taste, and then you'll be able to make your own best possible food and wine pairing. And I fully believe in that.
I think he was speaking last year in a symposium about New Zealand Sauvignon Blanc, and then he was, I think, mentioning about the wine and food pairings there.
He was invited to go there. I
remember.
He's a very interesting speaker, actually. The first time I heard him explain his theory was at the actually in Logroño, in the big wine symposium organized by Pancho Campo, and he was that was the first time I heard him explain his theories, and it was very interesting. And after that, I went to see him in California, actually, and we talked further about it. Great guy.
And the book that you were saying, its name is What Is Your Vinotype, right?
Vinotype, yes.
Vinotype, okay. Yeah. Someone is asking. I will post after the session. Tim Hennai. MW, what is your wine type? And there's a question from Gonzo again. She's asking, when did wine and food pairing became an issue in the gastronomy world historically?
I think it started already in the 19th century, to be honest. I think it started in France. I'm pretty sure it started in France, and it started when the French gastronomy was becoming really like something very influential in the world, and people started to copy it everywhere. And I think it was in that time that for the first time people really began to make it. I mean, it has been done before, I suppose, but then it became something really important. And since then, I suppose in the high-end restaurants, there has always been the focus on trying to pair the right wine with the right food.
Absolutely. Yeah. Maybe we can just slightly touch base to the Michelin side of the story, and then maybe later this month we can do a session about that. But it is, I think, like especially in the Michelin restaurants, when you do, depending where you are, but in Spain, there is this longest, never-ending tasting menus. Yeah. And also, if you add the wine pairing to that tasting menu, then you are in a really serious trouble. Because there's never-ending 20 courses, And plus, you have, I don't know how many wines per course.
Yeah.
It is, I don't know. Then I think to me, it is not an enjoyable and nice experience. It is just like so hectic, interrupting, and then you don't even remember the flavors anymore or the pairing of the wine and the food.
That's true. And that's a big problem in Spain at the moment. I mean, I know all these, I've been to almost all 3-star restaurants in Spain. And it went
which is a lot actually in Spain, which is a lot.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I say almost all, not all, but maybe 3 out of 4, something like that, 75%. Then it's becoming, it really went a bit out of control, to be honest. You know, I now get the impression in Spain that if you manage to cook 24 courses in 3 hours, you get your 3rd star. And there's much to say about it, but you know, to keep already the level of your courses, of your food up in with 24 courses in 3 hours is almost impossible. I suppose Can Roca is the one that does best in that respect. And even there, it's not always flawless. But then the wine pairing becomes a real problem because, of course, they will not serve you a wine with every course because that is impossible. But you often get like one wine for 2 or 3 courses. But it gets a bit messy on your table, you know, because all the time the sommelier comes running in. If you've got that kind of menu with wine menu, let's say 24 courses and 10 wines, you get 24 times an explanation what's on your dish. You get 10 times an explanation about the wine, not to forget the coffee and whatever. It means that you are there is no space for any normal social interaction anymore. You're just listening to waiters and sommeliers, and it's getting on my nerves, to be honest. It's too much.
And also, if you are trying to document, like taking pictures of what you are eating and posting, then you don't have a real experience. You're just having an augmented virtual reality experience.
I have to say, again, in Can Roca, I've been there twice, and I must say that the wine pairing that Pitu Roca is preparing is usually very well done. You know, there are not many failures there. I've had very, very good experiences in Aponiente, but you know, that is in a way almost easy because all the food in Aponiente comes from the ocean and the sea, going from any kind of fish or shellfish or whatever you can imagine, and including plankton and algae, whatever. And then they come with all these sherry wines or Palomino unfortified wines, and that they all have that very specific taste, and the matches, you can almost not go wrong in that match. So yeah, the food and wine pairing is great in Aponiente, but in a way it's always also relatively easy. Yeah.
I haven't been to none of neither of them. I haven't been.
Yeah.
Hopefully one day.
Yeah, we should go to. You have to go to Jerez with me one day.
Then we will do that. Yeah, let's do that.
Great area, but finally, to continue thinking back again to food and wine pairing and thinking about eating nowadays, because what we also should not forget is that if that modern high-end cooking involves a lot of flavors. Listen to the stories the waiters are telling you each time they bring you a plate in Spain, but also in many of the top restaurants in France. On your plate, you will find ba 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 ba. You're looking at your plate. You don't know where to look for it because it's too much, and you can't really see it because many things have been decomposed and changed and whatever. And with that multitude of flavors on your plate, you should match the perfect wine. It's almost impossible.
Impossible. So that's why for those tasting menus, normally what I prefer is like just having one bottle, which can go well with everything, just enjoy it. And I bet you in those situations, like 95% of the people, they don't listen or they don't pay attention, or they just seem to listen and pay attention. They don't understand what they're explaining about the food because it's impossible. And if you multiply this with 26 times,
They're too busy making photos anyway.
Yeah. I think we should make a session about wine. Michelin
star. Yeah.
Okay. One last question here, and then let's wrap up the session. Fedeluye is asking, what are the suggested not to do in wine pairing, like Sauternes and desserts, and which meats in wine pairing are not true?
It's difficult to answer, and there are too many of them. But for, let's say, our views have changed, of course, over time. Let's take the old adagium that with cheese you should drink red wine. And mm-hmm. we realize meanwhile that this is usually not true. But of course, it has to do with the order of a menu in French, in the French kitchen. Whereas, mm-hmm. because in France, you will get cheese after your main course, before dessert. So what do mm-hmm. you drink? Red wine, because you're still in red wine, you know. Mm-hmm. The Brits used to add port at that stage and drink a port with cheese. But we realize nowadays that in many, many cases, not all cases, but in many cases, cheeses actually go best with white wines. And this can be, and it depends on the kind of cheese, what kind of white wine you serve. Huh? Mm-hmm. I think to come with general rules and even general rules on what not to do, the issue is too complicated for that. Mm-hmm. Like we realize today that actually fish and red wine can also be in certain cases an excellent combination. You know?
Combination, yeah.
Whereas 25 years ago, we would have said that's rubbish, it doesn't work.
Yeah.
Red wine should always be meat.
Meat, yeah. But in that case, depending on the red wine and depending on the fish, for example, myself, I wouldn't do a really tannic red wine with sushi because it will make, I think, the sushi taste more metallic.
Yes.
You know, this thing, I think that's something that I would never do.
No.
But the rest, I think I could just try anything.
Yes, most there's a lot more possible than you believe, actually. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's true.
Okay, great. Thank you, Frank. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
And a takeaway note from today's session, just enjoy it. Don't make it complicated.
Exactly.
Drink and eat whatever you like.
Yes, and enjoy that. Yes. Asiatico and slowly cooked lamb.
Is it good or bad?
Not
to do? Or maybe she's mentioning it's something not to do.
Is it a bad combination? I don't know. It depends on the asiatico, actually. If it is barrel fermented and it has a bit of weight, then it could do with lamb. Why not?
Yeah. Actually, Nihteri style asiatico could go, I think, well with the slow cooked lamb, no?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would think so.
I think so.
Yeah. I'm not so. Yeah.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, everyone, for your comments and questions, for participation. Next week on Monday, we are not doing a session because Frank has a personal. Sorry.
Yes, I have a real lecture to give.
Real lecture, physically.
Where we're tasting, you know, in the Netherlands, we are slowly opening up now, and. It's possible now to restart. We're actually in this case a level 3 course, and I'm looking uh-huh. forward to that after 2 months.
After 2 months, yeah.
I mean,
great.
Online is fine, but life is better. Yes.
Yeah, personal connection and so on. So enjoy your weekend and your
Thank you.
On Monday.
Yes.
Next week we will be on Wednesday and Friday again, yes. same time. We will talk about natural wines and biodynamic wines.
Yeah,
and then. Robert Parker, the man.
Yes, and people will be surprised about what I have to say about him.
Yes, I will be surprised as well.
Good.
Okay.
Great.
Great. Thank you. Bye bye.
Thank you.
Bye everyone.
Bye.
Bye. Oh, yes. Okay. I'm just going to make a reminder here.
Good.
Bye, Frank.
Bye.
Bye. Okay, I just said bye to Frank. One reminder to follow a diploma holder and wine academic friend of mine, Ricardo Herrera, and I'll be doing a blind tasting challenge tomorrow, 1 p.m. Spanish time. So I'll see you tomorrow. Bye, everyone.